let me know whenever I can start anytime.
Yes, so I will introduce you and then,
I cannot
welcome.
See. So, yeah, sorry, I can only see my slides. I guess that's, okay.
When you are sharing, that's that's the case.
Okay, so I guess somebody can just stop me. Yeah.
Yes, and remember that I will keep an eye on the, on the chat. Yeah. Okay, so welcome everybody to the online seminar series Machine Learning Needs Mathematical Optimization. So today we are extremely pleased to have Theos Evgeniou, who is a professor, full professor of decision science and technology management at INSEAD. And he's also the director of the INSEAD Executive Education Program on Transforming Your Business with Artificial Intelligence. So he has been working on machine learning and artificial intelligence for the past 25 years on areas ranging from artificial intelligence innovation for business process optimization and improving decisions in marketing and finance to the regulation of artificial intelligence. So he has published in journals that are very renowned, such as Science, Machine Learning, Management Science, Marketing Science, Harvard Business Review, Lancet Digital Health, among others. And on the top of this busy agenda, he is a member of the OECD network of experts on artificial intelligence. He's also an advisor for the BCG Henderson Institute and an advisor for the World Economic Forum Academic Panel for Artificial Intelligence. So we are very thankful, Theos, that you found the time to come today. And the floor is yours. If the audience has very, very urgent questions, please put them on the chat and I will read them for Theos. If not, at the end, you will have the chance to ask questions. So thank you very much again for coming today.
Thank you so much, Dolores, and very nice to e-meet everybody. As I mentioned, I cannot see anything on my screen other than my slides, so please just talk on Dolores, interrupt me anytime you need it. I'll talk about some work I've been doing the past couple of years in a space that I didn't know anything about before, so relatively new myself in this area. Regarding explainability, which is AI explainability, which is not necessarily as mathematical, and it's not. I will not focus on a specific piece of paper, but I will cover a couple of different pieces of work I've been doing within this theme. And I must say beforehand that I'm afraid I will probably raise more questions than answers, and hopefully some of the questions will be interesting. And I'll be, of course, happy to answer whatever questions you may have if I can too. But again, this is a lot of those things are also new for me. So, and as you will see, they touch different aspects and different kind of fields from math to behavioral economics to regulation kind of work, et cetera, et cetera. Experimental work also. And I'm not an expert in definitely not all of them and most likely none of them. So hopefully it will be, give you a broader view of some things I've been working on and try to go as much in depth as possible. AI explainability is a topic that has been kind of in vogue for the past few years, maybe 5 years or so, for many reasons. And I find it very exciting also and very interesting because in a sense it has something philosophical about this, about what does it mean that we understand something as humans and what does it mean to explain something. How can we make computers kind of, how can we develop algorithms that give explanations that make sense or that build trust? How can we in general build trust to AI systems, AI embedded systems and solutions and software and products and services, while at the same time having safety. So trust is not enough, right? So you can trust something which is unsafe. So we care about trust, but we care actually even more so about safety. I mean, we care about both. Trust is important for adoption, for example, but then eventually you also have safety over time. Of course, they feed each other. And the topic has been become important also because of a lot of regulations and because a lot of the work in Europe and also in other parts of the world regarding trustworthy AI. So this relates to the AI Act of the EU that talks about transparency and explainability and trustworthiness of AI, et cetera, et cetera. And this is part of, just to give a bit of context here, this is an area I'm very much interested in, and anybody working on this or interested in this, I'm happy to connect offline, regarding new digital regulations coming into play as we speak, in different themes, not just on AI, but also on the internet. So all this discussion we see nowadays in the media about Elon Musk and Twitter and freedom and safety, is like this basically the whole space of online trust and safety, with lots of regulations coming in, like the European Digital Services Act, that basically, in a sense, help us regulate online platforms and, in some sense, the internet, right? So it's a big question. The same with AI and also other kind of regulations regarding digital, which in many ways, arguably, these kind of regulations have been lagging technological innovation. So the commercial internet has been around for roughly 25 years or so, let's say, but it was pretty much the Wild West until recently. And of course, AI is the next kind of big thing that will be regulated, et cetera, et cetera. So it's a lot of work to be done to ensure that technologies, of course, are not only useful in terms of productivity, let's say, but also trustworthy and safe. Explainability, of course, for AI is a specific aspect of it. And we had a couple of different funny stories, like maybe many of you are familiar with the Apple Card, credit card example, where the well-known person was accepted, that his spouse was rejected, and he was trying to find out why he was rejected by the algorithm, and the only answer he would get is, it's just the algorithm, right? So nobody understands why the algorithm rejected somebody, a credit card, an Apple credit card. Anyway, that's just a popular version of lots of different kinds of stories that can happen. It's been also a topic that DARPA has put quite a lot of effort on in the US, and similarly in other parts of the world, of course. They had like a big major call for proposals and the funding for explainable AI, back 4 years ago or something, and the whole idea is, of course, how to develop explainable AI in different applications, from transportation to medicine to finance, legal, military, etc. It's a difficult topic. It's a little bit a science fiction topic in some ways. At the end of the day, one has to ask, what does it mean? We don't even know what an explanation really means. Explanation of means understanding, basically. This kind of field, this kind of research stream, if you like, or topic, it's exciting because, as I mentioned, it can also help us maybe better understand human nature in many ways, of course, right? Because we're having to codify and write an algorithm, not necessarily codify, but use machine learning to actually let the machines codify in some ways, decision making and explanations about the decisions. And understand, you know, why did the algorithm make this? Why did the model make this decision? Now, just before I want to step back a bit and clarify what we're talking about here. So this is a kind of a mental model about so-called the three gap framework from some work back about 15 years ago from the, let's say, the MIS community. In this case, this is from the Information Systems Research Journal back then. That kind of summarizes a little bit what we're talking about here in some sense. We're trying to explain, we may want to explain how the model works, right? So how did the model work? That's one thing we can explain. Or we're trying to explain how the reality is. For example, why is the spouse of this person rejected? The card, is it, that's what the model rejected the person, but okay, that's understanding the model. However there is a reality behind this, which is whether the spouse was creditworthy or not, whether the risk of default was high or not. That's kind of the truth. If you want to understand the truth, that's a different question. Understanding the model does not necessarily allow us to understand the truth, although it can help us. But it may also actually take us away from that. I'll come back to this a bit later. And then there is also the mental model of the manager. So what you think you understand may not be exactly what the model does, nor exactly what the reality is. So somehow there are these gaps that we'll have to kind of close. And explainable AI research, if you like, can help us actually kind of close these three gaps, get closer to reality, have models which are closer to reality, and also help the manager or the user in general. It doesn't have to be a manager. It can be a decision data scientist, it can be a customer, it can be a user, it can be whoever, a tester, a developer, et cetera, et cetera. And each of them have their own mental models and for different reasons. And we can help them also kind of refine their mental model of the world and of the model, the decision science, the data science model, sorry. Or decision support model, if you like, depends on what the DS in this case calls, stands for decision support. So we're talking about here explainability of the model. And let me start by some, as I mentioned, I'll kind of try to raise more questions. We have been kind of, there's been a big community in computer science developing AI explainability algorithms. And some of you may have seen that kind of work. There is like well-known algorithms like LIME and SHAP and other counterfactual explanations, et cetera, et cetera, lots of them. And there has been lots of also, you know, excellent mathematical work, algorithmic work, you know, kind of theorems, et cetera, being proven in that space with lots of innovation and big kind of some important breakthroughs in some ways. But before diving into developing explanations using algorithms, in a sense, so one more thing here. We have an AI algorithm that does something, a machine learning algorithm, deep learning, whatever, random forest, doesn't matter what, that does something. Let's say classification about, you know, somebody should get credit or not, depending on, you know, the probability of default estimation. And then we can have another algorithm on top of that, which is trying to develop an explanation about the first one. Right? So explainable AI is a lot about developing algorithms or methods, if you like, to develop explanations about another machine learning algorithm, which the second one can be called a black box sometimes. So there is a black box which makes decisions, it could be a random forest deep learning or whatever. And then there's another algorithm, which explainable AI algorithm, that's kind of trying to explain what the black box is doing using simple, human understandable, ideally, kind of explanations, if you like. I'll come back to examples of what kind of explanations later on. And the whole idea is that if we can explain how the black box behaves, then maybe we can help build trust of users towards the AI model. But is that really always the case? Could AI to begin with AI explanations erode trust to the AI? As important, do AI explanations, does providing AI explanations really improve safety? And do we even need AI explainability for trust to begin with? Can we have like no AI explainability, yet more trust and more safety? But these are some kind of first order questions that I have to kind of answer and understand. And of course, the answer is not yes or no. The answer can be yes or no in different contexts, and it's much more nuanced. So that's one of the areas I've been kind of trying to understand. These kind of questions I've been working on for the past part of my work in this area for the past couple of years. We start from like the first two. Could AI explanations erode trust or even maybe not really improve safety? So this is what we argue. We argue in an article in Science Magazine with my collaborators from Harvard Law School and Molinsiad. In an article in Science that's called Beware Explanations from AI in Healthcare, where we focus on healthcare specifically, which is what the EU Commission calls a high-risk AI application, of course, right? So the use of AI systems in healthcare, like for AI diagnosis or recommendation of treatment, et cetera, et cetera. There we argue that, in fact, for such high-risk applications of AI, which are also high expertise, high knowledge applications, healthcare is like you really need to be an expert to understand what's happening, providing explanations to, let's say, patients or non-expert doctors may actually be dangerous and misleading, right? So misleading and even worse, dangerous. And just to start giving a little bit of some arguments why that can be the case, here is an example, right? So first of all, we have to understand that it's the explanations that come out as, let's say, a rule that says you've been diagnosed with cancer. The AI system, right, has diagnosed you with cancer with probability, you know, 95% because, you know, XYZ, right? XYZ are variables that come out from the algorithm. We have to have a sense about how believable, how credible is this kind of explanations. And some explanations may look like algorithmically correct, but when we read them as humans, we don't really trust them. So here's an example, for example, just a toy example. One morning, a judge or parole officer issues a series of summary decisions denying parole to a group of defendants. The defendants object, requesting an explanation for the refusal of parole. In response, the judge's assistant looks at their files and notices a pattern. So here's the explanation, right? Each defendant denied parole has two or more prior offenses, while those granted parole do not. And that's the explanation provided. Now, basically it says that whoever was had two or more prior offenses was denied and everybody else was granted parole. It sounds like an algorithmic explanation, potentially, maybe statistically even correct, but when we hear it, it's like, it doesn't sound right somehow. Something fishy about it. It sounds like too naive, maybe too kind of hiding things behind. There's no causality here, really, et cetera, et cetera. So how can we ensure that, for example, if an algorithm provides this kind of explanation, do we trust the algorithm better? Not necessarily. We may actually lose trust because this explanation is kind of makes no sense, really, to us. That's at least the first question to understand. The explanations may make no sense, in which case, because there is no such, again, back to philosophical questions in some sense, what does it mean that the AI, explainable AI algorithm gave an explainable explanation? We call it explanation, but it may make no sense according to the user. More kind of questions we kind of discuss in this article. What if the AI explainability algorithm generates very different explanations for very similar inputs? So you have two similar customers or patients or applicants or whatever, and they get, you know, the same, let's say, response from the AI decision-making system, the black box. But when you get like the explanations about why they got this kind of response, let's say both of them got rejected the credit card, even though they're very similar people, the explainable AI algorithm gives very different explanations. If the user sees that, maybe the user, the person who uses the, let's say, the credit the credit manager of the bank sees very different explanations coming out of this explainable AI algorithm for very similar applicants, will the bank, the credit bank manager really trust the algorithms? Not necessarily. What happens if there are multiple explanations, right? So which one do you choose, and how can you game the patient, sorry, the applicant or the user or the patient, you know, by giving the explanation that you feel it's, you know, would be most convincing? What if they are not actionable, of course? Could explanations lead to overconfidence or to narrative fallacy, just, you know, especially in healthcare? So my favorite kind of pessimistic example is, you know, my mom, and I'm sure for most of our moms, right? My mom goes to a pharmacy, gets asked for a drug, asks for an explanation about why the drug works. I'm sure, especially, you know, where I come from, she will get an explanation. That explanation can be like a totally random explanation that, you know, just because she was told that, let's say, this, you know, drug has some special herb that, you know, makes you healthy and energetic, et cetera, she will start believing that it's better to get those kind of herbs. It's like a narrative fallacy, right? And becomes confident, overconfident, that, okay, we have to all get those herbs because those herbs make you, you know, healthy and energetic and young, which, of course, is most of the time, you know, not at all correct, but, you know, it leads to kind of conspiracy theories kind of thing, right? Just because you got an explanation. So could explanations actually lead to overconfidence or to narrative fallacy? I have really studied this, when and what people, et cetera, et cetera. Moreover, what kind of explanations could work better for different users or different, depending on the context? So as I mentioned, there are different types of algorithms giving different types of explanations. I'll come to this later. So these questions in italics, I'll kind of do a deep dive in those a bit more. So we may want to use different kind of AI explanations for different kind of contexts and users. And a topic that has been heavily discussed was also about the cost of explainability or the cost of comprehensibility, which means, let's say we insist that we will have to use only so-called white boxes, meaning AI algorithms that give a model, an AI model that we can all understand, like a simple classification tree or a simple logistic regression kind of with few parameters, with few independent variables. If the regulator insists, or if, you know, we insist to use only very simple, understandable methods, how much of accuracy do we forego in terms of, you know, how accurately these methods predict, let's say, whether somebody will default relative to using something which is, you know, a black box random forest, for example? What's this trade-off between accuracy and explainability? Again, I'll do a deep dive on this one. Finally, do we really need explanations? I mean, or we can do without. So for example, when we get in pharmaceutical, in the medical space, when we get a drug, we don't need an explanation about how the drug works chemically for us to trust it. And in fact, you know, we don't get any such explanation because it's even potentially risky to get these kind of explanations. So if we don't need explanations about why a drug works in order for us to trust it, why do we need explanation about how an AI makes a decision in order for us to trust it? Right. So the question is, if we don't need explanations to trust a drug or an AI algorithm, then what else can we consider in order to build trust? And for example, in the pharmaceutical world, what we trust is not the explanation why a drug works, because that we don't understand anyway. What we trust is the process through which the drug was developed. And we know that the regulator, or the Food and Drug Administration, or whatever in the US, or the European Medicine Regulator, they have followed a very rigorous process. They have, you know, did clinical trials, you know, tested, checked the laboratories whether they follow good practices, et cetera, et cetera. So we may not want to build trust based on outcomes, but based on process. Not about how the AI decides, but how the AI was developed. And in fact, the US Food and Drug Administration has been talking for a few years now about so-called good machine learning practices that need to be followed by companies that develop AI medical devices. Much like they are examining laboratories, wet labs, to make sure that they follow, you know, they are clean and follow, like, you know, very, you know, follow the regulations in terms of how safe the laboratories are and how clean and organized they are, et cetera, et cetera. Same for the process of developing the algorithms. Have good processes, good practices been followed? So lots of questions here and lots of work to be done, of course. Now I'll dive into a couple of those questions, the ones in italics, the last three, and mostly on the one about the types of explanations that work better and also the cost of comprehensibility. But briefly, regarding whether we really need explanations for trust and what are the alternatives other than managing the process of development, I'll just give a glimpse of something else I'm working on as we speak. This is actually a piece of work we're doing. We just finished the complete draft literally last week or so. Again, with more or less the same team from Harvard Law and from marketing at INSEAD, with Klaus, is a colleague of Klaus Bertenbruch, is a colleague of mine at marketing, Kyung Chi is a PhD student of mine, and Glenn Cohen and Sarah Gerker from law schools, and Boris Babich was an ex-colleague of mine who's now in the University of Toronto Philosophy Department. We are kind of studying the process of of using AI as, in practice. What do I mean by this? Lots of the discussion in recently has been about the so-called human in the loop. So there is, you know, depending on the context, there is, in some context at least, there is a so-called algorithmic aversion, and people don't like an algorithm to make a decision for them, right? They don't trust, et cetera, et cetera, the algorithm. They prefer a human. And they prefer also a combination of humans and machines, basically, human and algorithm. So you need to have a human in the loop. What we are analyzing here is we may need to think about the involvement of a human, not, and just to explain here, human in the loop typically means that a human is involved before a decision is made. So let's say we are deciding whether somebody will get a credit card or not, a credit scoring algorithm, you know, gives a prediction and classifies this person as credit worthy or not credit worthy, for example. The final decision may need to be made by a human who sees this prediction of the AI algorithm and then makes the final decision. So the human is in the loop, or at least, you know, overrides the decision of AI anytime. Right? Here, what we are studying in this project is not so much the involvement of a human before a decision is made, before the decision to give credit to somebody or not is made and communicated to the applicant, but so much what happens after a decision is made. And what we argue is that for a number of reasons, and again, lots of questions here, for a number of reasons, we may be better off to actually not involve people before a decision is made, but only after a decision is made, and only if the stakeholder affected by the decision, in this case the applicant for a credit card, appeals to the decision, to the AI. So basically, we have AI systems used to make decisions automatically, and if the applicant of a credit card does not agree with the decision of the AI, that's when they have the right to appeal, which of course they always do, and that's where you put a human in the appeal process, not in the pre-decision process. And this can have, of course, huge implications. To begin with, it's much more scalable. You don't have to have people involved in every single decision. You have people involved and only the best experts involved only in the very difficult cases, which are also the most informative cases, which are the cases where the applicant or the stakeholder affected actually appeals and complains, right? So it's much more scalable, much more, you leverage better the experts, you have more focus on the difficult informative cases that you can also use to improve the algorithms, and you also potentially give the stakeholder, the applicant in this case, a better sense of control, as they can, of course, always appeal, right? Of course, and then the question is, how do we design processes which are effective that are appeal processes to AI decisions? And part of the rationale behind this research stream has to do with ongoing discussions as we speak, I mean, including in the OECD and, of course, you know, in other organizations, about building what's called AI incidence databases. So, which is basically what it says, right? So which are databases where basically there is reporting of AI incidences, right? And then the question is, what's the process of reporting AI incidences? Because if there is no process, then you can actually, you know, lose track of, you may have lots of noise there, right? And how do you best set up this kind of AI incidences, AI appeals, appealing to AI, right? Appealing to AI decisions, processes. How do you do this? And that's kind of some of the questions that we are studying in this piece of work. And again, it's very early days, but thinking about designing effective and efficient processes where the humans are involved after a decision is made automatically by an AI and only if needed, is something that needs, of course, you know, a lot of work going forward, and it's kind of new research questions in some ways. Okay, so let me go back now to, sorry, I'll go back to kind of a broad view of the kind of different things I've been looking into. Happy to get questions, of course. I don't see any questions, but if there's any, happy to pause here briefly, because then I will do a deep dive on those two kind of specific projects, the accuracy and explainability, if you like, trade-off, and kind of a little bit what kind of explanations do people like across different contexts. Well, again, if there is no specific question, now let me move on here. So in this work that has appeared in Big Data this year, this work we study as a question that has been kind of, for which there was, there has been in general the past couple of years, a theoretical answer. And the question has been, if we only use so-called white boxes, meaning algorithms that build models which are easy for humans to understand. Again, like a small classification, let's say in the case of classification, a small classification trees or simple rules, right? Or a linear or logistic regression with a few independent variables, right? Instead of building, let's say, complicated black boxes like random forest or non-linear supported vector machines or deep learning or whatever, multi-layered perceptrons, etc., how much accuracy would we lose? And the typical kind of theoretical plot, if you like, and this is your theoretical, the plot you see here, which comes actually from the DARPA call, is somehow there is some kind of linear trade-off between accuracy, learning performance, and explainability. So you trade one for the other. So we said, okay, let's study this. Is that really the case or not? And part of the reason we want to study this is because it has been a little bit of a controversial question. Some people, like Cynthia Rudin, has been saying, we don't need black boxes most of the time. White boxes are good enough. Others would say, no, black boxes, if we only use white boxes, we lose a lot of accuracy. So we set out an empirical study where basically what we've done, and of course, before I go into more detail, just a couple of disclaimers. There is no way to answer the question, what's the trade-off between using an explainable algorithm versus accuracy in general? Because, of course, it depends on the data, it depends on which algorithms you tried, it depends, you know, how what kind of hyperparameter search you did, it depends on a thousand things. So, of course, there is no way to have a complete answer to this question. And, you know, one has to test all data sets available with all algorithms available, and even then. Right. So, and there are lots of other tops here. Plus, you know, what does it mean that an algorithm is explainable? What does it mean it's a white box? Again, back to what I said before, the fact that we have a very simple classification tree or a very simple linear regression with a few independent variables, it does not mean that it's really explainable, let alone does not mean that it really closes the gap between the mental model of the manager, let's say, and the reality, the truth, back to the original three gaps model, that framework that I mentioned. Right. So these are caveats, of course. With these caveats, what we've done here was we said, okay, how about we take, how about we take, you know, a bunch of kind of standard data sets that have been used for benchmark studies, and we focused only on so-called tabular data, so not images, multimedia, not speech, not video, not you know, audio, not images, but tabular data, like in Excel, right? So which is the majority of the data people use in business, of course. Why don't we take a bunch of tabular data that people have been studying and using in all sorts of different benchmarking studies and do a very simple analysis. For each, so we took about 95 or so, 97 different kind of benchmark data sets. And for each of those 97 data sets, let's find the best black box model. Now, of course, again, there's no way to find the best black box model unless you try all the black box models and you do them all of them carefully. So, in this case, of course, we tried a number of black box models that have been in the literature used or shown to be like the best ones for this kind of data sets. And we also trained the best white box model. And again, there we have only a few of them we used, of course, some of the most commonly used ones. And then we kind of see across different data sets, what's the difference in testing per out of sample accuracy, predictive accuracy between the best black box and the best white box. So this is the black box model. This is the best native white box. I'll explain why I say it native. And the question is, what's the difference in accuracy between the best black box and the best white box for across data sets? That's the first empirical question. Second question was, very often what one can do is use a black box, but then use an explainable AI algorithm to develop a so-called surrogate white box, which basically is a white box, a simple tree or logistic regression or linear regression with a few independent variables that kind of mimics the black box. So basically, what's the idea of a surrogate white box? Let's say I train a deep learning network on my data set. Then what I can do is I can take the deep learning model that was developed, was estimated, and then for my training data, again using the training data, I can put as input to my deep learning model the training data inputs and get as labels, in the case of classification or regression, of course, the same thing, get as labels, as output, some labels. So the label can be, you know, let's say we do classification, the labels will be 0 or 1, you know, default, not default, or whatever it is. And then let the black box predict the labels of my training data. And then train a white box on those labels. So you don't train the white box on the original labels of the training data we had, but we train the white box on the prediction of the black box, which may sound a little bit perverse, but actually it turns out to be a pretty good idea very often. And this was already well known, actually, that somehow, it's an interesting question why, there are some hypotheses about this. If you train a complex black box on a set of data, and then you train a simple white box to mimic the black box by training the simple white box on the predictions of the black box, somehow, sometimes you can do better than training a white box directly on the training data. So you don't train it on the training data, you're training on the labels, same inputs, but different labels, on the labels of the black box. And that works better sometimes. Part of the reason is because the black box sometimes removes noise from the data. So we call this a surrogate white box. So we also see how well that does, which is a bit of a convoluted way to create an explainable model by going through a black box first. Now, The title of the article, "The Nonlinear Nature," the nonlinear nature of the cost of comprehensibility, came out from this kind of what I described as before I go there. This is a little bit the process we followed. Anyway, I don't have to go in detail. The kind of black boxes we use was like random forest, nonlinear SVMs with Gaussian kernels, multilayer perceptrons. The kind of white box was decision tree, linear logistic regression, sorry, and Reaper, which are rule-based system. And then we use like Reaper and Trepan and the rule fit decision trees and logistic regression as surrogate modeling. And again, this is not of course exhaustive. And we compared based on F1 score because the data were unbalanced, but also based on just accuracy. Right. Now, briefly, across the 97 data sets, on average, the black boxes, in this case, those three black boxes, were performing similarly on average, and all of them better than the white boxes. This is, in this case, there are six methods, and this is the relative ranking. So one is the best method, six is the worst method. So the relative ranking of the methods was kind of 2.7 for the black boxes and 4.5 or whatever it is for the white boxes. So lower rank the white boxes. Better. The black boxes on average indeed are better. So in some sense, the first order answer to the question, is it worth using black boxes in terms of better accuracy? First order answer is yes, you get better accuracy on average. Good to know. On average, you get better accuracy when you use black boxes, which is in a sense a good news because it means that, okay, we didn't waste our time developing all those complicated algorithms. That's a first order answer. However, the title of the paper came out from this plot, which at least to me was extremely surprising. And when we first saw this plot, I found it to be, and I still find it to be one of the most interesting plots I've seen in the kind of things I've been working on, maybe ever. What is this plot about? So here, what we do is we, on the y-axis, right, the relative difference is effectively the relative difference, which is the difference divided by, so let's say the accurate of the F1 score or the accuracy, same thing, the same results we get. F1 score is a little bit like, let's say, the accuracy measure, if you like, the accuracy of the best black box on the dataset minus the accuracy of the best white box on the dataset divided by the accuracy of the best white box. Right? So it's a relative accuracy. I think divided by the sum of the two, maybe it doesn't matter too much anyway. And here on the x-axis, we ordered the data sets according to how big this difference was. So the first data set was the one where the white, this negative number, right? So this means that a negative number means that the white box was much better than the black box. So it's almost like 99% or something. This side here, the data set number 97, is the one where the black box is much better than the white box. The relative ratio is 0.7 or so, 70% better, basically, roughly. Okay. Now, why is this an interesting plot? The interesting thing here is that, first of all, this is definitely not like a linear curve. This is highly nonlinear. That's why we call it the nonlinear nature of the cost of comprehensibility. Right? Indeed, on average, the black boxes, based on this result, are working better than the white boxes across all data sets. But this difference is driven by very few data sets. For most of the data sets, black box is zero. You don't gain anything by doing something sophisticated or complicated for the majority of them. And then there are very few of them here where the black box is really much better. And a few of them, like five of them or something, like these ones, where you really pay a huge price by limiting yourself to a simple white box method. On the other hand, interestingly, there are also a very few of them, like a couple of data sets here in our list, where actually the white box is significantly better than the best black box. So it's a very nonlinear relationship if you plot it this way. And effectively, you see that indeed, most of the time, no reason to do something sophisticated. We then studied We then studied what's so special about datasets which, for which the best black box works better. These are called, we call them opaque datasets. What's special about them? First of all, interesting observation was that for these opaque datasets, which are the ones for the best black box, which was really much better, the surrogate white box was also better than the native white box. So for the datasets for which you are better off using a complicated black box model, if you really want a comprehensible model, you are better off to first train a black box and then develop a surrogate white box trained on the outputs of the black box than to do a white box from scratch. Interesting. I mean, otherwise, for other datasets, it made no difference. Next question was like, okay, then that was kind of a, I don't think that's an easy question to answer, but I think it's an important one, which is, can we understand better, let's say, you know, a regulator goes to a company and says, you know, why are you using a deep learning method for this data set, right? Why don't you use something which is comprehensible? And the company can say, well, because the deep learning black box method we have works significantly better, much, much better than like any simple white box model we can develop. All right, so how can the regulator really confirm this, right? Or anybody else can confirm, or a customer or whatever, anybody, right? One way to go around this is to say, okay, of course, you know, you can give me the data and I can play around, but that won't happen. The question is, can we get answers to some questions about the nature of the data that can help us understand whether the company was actually telling the truth? So, for example, I don't want to know what models you are using, but can you give me answers to the following questions? If I was to use a linear hyperplane to separate the data in the case of classification, let's say, how accurate is that linear hyperplane, and for what percentage of the data does it do a reasonably good job? Moreover, how much noise is there in your data? How well is a nearest neighbor classifier performing, right, for your data? And how does the model best fit as you potentially increase or decrease the number of attributes you use? Now, what are those characteristics? These are characteristics, four characteristics out of about 100 characteristics that we used that came out from, just parentheses here. There's a whole field which is called meta-learning, which has to do also a little bit with what in the industry people develop that's called auto-ML, auto-machine learning, where basically the question there is, what are the characteristics of the data that make some algorithms be more appropriate than other algorithms? And in that field, people have developed about, you know, tens of characteristics of data, literally, actually hundreds, not just tens, including the ones you see here. So what we did basically here is we took all those standard characteristics of data sets that people in the meta-learning AutoML community have been studying, and we simply studied what's the difference between the opaque data sets that I mentioned here, the ones where, what's the difference between basically this data here, the opaque data where the best black box does really much better, and these ones, right? We just did classify the data sets effectively. And these are kind of the features that came out as being statistically significant across the 97 different data sets. So basically we run, there are many ways to do this. So we run variations, but if you wish, we run a regression, a linear regression across the 97 data sets we had, where the independent variables were the 100 or so characteristics of every data set. So we had 97 times 100 table, and the dependent variable was the relative difference in performance, the y-axis here, between the best black box and the best white box. And these were like the four statistically significant variables that came out of this. Again, is it really the best way to do this? Probably not. But at least it starts giving us a sense about what kind of characteristics of data make some data more opaque. I'll skip this. Just briefly, I know we have to leave some time for questions, but basically so far, in terms of again, it's important to kind of step back and ask some behavioral questions and some questions about, you know, does explainability really help or not, and what can be the possible risks of giving AI explanations. We have to understand a bit the cost of comprehensibility, and there's lots of more work to do over there. potentially think about how we can build trust without necessarily giving explanations, and how to involve humans in ways which are more effective and more efficient, like potentially in appeals, but not in decisions, right? Pre-decision. So these are kind of topics I've been studying. Just to close, and I'll spend only 2 minutes on this, because I realize we don't have much time. Another piece of work we've done with a different set of co-authors, from including some of the same people and some different, including Olivier Tubia from Columbia, and Janu and Tom and David from University of Antwerp. Here we are studying the question: what type of explanations are preferred by for different contexts? Now, let me step back a little bit and go back to the beginning. When we talk about AI explanations, we talk about explanations that today's explainable AI algorithms can develop, right? So we are constrained by the type of explanations explainable AI algorithms can develop. We cannot just have whatever explanations. And today's explainable AI algorithms, well, there are many of them, but a couple of most standard types of explanations they provide are so-called importance ranking-based of explanations, or so-called counterfactual explanations. There is also sample-based explanations. There is, you know, other more causal inference-based explanations, et cetera, et cetera. But these two ones, importance ranking and counterfactual, are very, very, very common methods. In the importance ranking, the explanation is basically giving you the relative importance of every feature that mattered for the AI outcome decision. For the counterfactual, what you are doing is you are trying to give the smallest possible list of features of, let's say, the credit card applicant, that if those features were different, so you're looking for the smallest possible set of features, it's a difficult problem, you know, kind of NP kind of thing, that the smallest possible set of features, that if those features were different, the AI algorithm would have come up with a different outcome. So, and the question we studied was like, what kind of explanations do people prefer? Counterfactual versus importance ranking. How complex, how many different features should the explanation give, depending on the context? And also, what kind of so-called the specificity of the explanation, for example, high versus low specificity. I'll give an example here. So specificity means, so here's an example. So here is the kind of experiments we did with people, where we gave them like a choice, a story, let's say. A story is like, in this case, Helena travel loan application got rejected. If you were Helena, which of the two explanations shown below that explain the credit decision would you prefer? Right. We followed what's called in marketing a conjoint analysis kind of approach. It's a very standard marketing methodology, conjoint analysis. And the kind of and we asked people to compare the different types of explanations for different kind of scenarios, in different kind of contexts. And we played with the types, counterfactual versus importance ranking. We played with a number of attributes in every explanation, and we also played varied the specificity. Specificity being high or low depending on whether you go to details. For example, in this case, the explanation goes to the level of detail about saving, right? The amount in savings increased by if the amount of savings had increased by $5,000, right? Or if your number of dependents decreased by one, of course, you know, some of those things are not practical, obviously, then you would be given credit. Well, in this case, it's more high level. The specificity is very low, basically. Very high level description. So if your saving behavior was different, but without telling you, you know, how different should it be, right? So same here. We don't tell you, in this explanation, you say you were shown this advertisement because you visited the website basketballtips.com or skysport.com. So it's very detailed, right? Versus low specificity, you were shown this advertisement because you visited web pages related to basketball. We don't tell you which one, right? So in a sense, yeah, so the question we are studying is, if we vary those attributes depending on the context. Now, what kind of contexts? The context we considered high or low stakes, so online advertisement considered low stakes versus loan applications, where again you can have small amount loan versus big amount loan, right? So very high stakes. We consider also positive versus negative decisions. So So scenarios where we say things like, you were given credit because of this, or you were not given credit because of this. So depending on the decision, is it positive or negative decision, and depending on the what's at stake, high or low stake, what kind of explanation along those three features do people prefer? So not to endure also time, and I'll stop there. We followed the choice-based conjoint analysis, had those three attributes per explanation. Basically, we treated explanations like the way people in marketing treat products. When in conjoint analysis, usually you show people two products and you ask them which one do you prefer, for example. Here, we didn't show two products. We showed two explanations with different features, characteristics. And we also, we use the classic marketing methodology, hierarchical-based estimation, to find the parameters of the models that explain what kind of, which of those three features people prefer. Long story short, I'm going to skip these results, just to give like a summary. In general, again, these are preliminary results. There are a number of different things we have to fix and work on, so this is in many ways also a work in progress. Counterfactual explanations were preferred more for negative decisions and for high stakes, even more so. So if you are rejected a mortgage, you prefer a counterfactual explanation that says, if you had changed that and that characteristic, you would have taken the mortgage. On the other hand, if you were shown an advertisement and you ask, why was I shown this advertisement, you probably prefer an explanation that says you were shown this advertisement because you visited those websites before, and not a counterfactual one, right? Of course, in terms of complexity, there obviously the complexity is very high, people don't like it, but we were after more the question about how complex should the explanation be, how many features should it use. So we varied between 3 and 7, I think, or 3 and 6, I don't remember, and we found generally people like a relatively moderate amount of complexity, prefer kind of more details for high risk applications and less details for low risk applications, right? And we also studied, we used this kind of cognitive test, a standard cognitive test people use in the studies, to kind of get a metric of the cognitive style, how kind of deliberative the cognitive style of subjects were. We also saw that kind of more the higher the cognitive test score of people, the more they prefer kind of more detailed explanation, which in a sense is not very surprising. But this is a kind of, and there's some more work here. So that's all I want to talk about, and we'll have like a few minutes for more discussion. As I said, hopefully this was raising some questions which are interesting. I think we're still early on in this area. There is a lot of questions to answer. There is a lot of amazing work being done already, but there's also a lot more to do, which covers things from like, you know, philosophical questions about what is really good explanation, or how do we close the different gaps between the mental model of a user and the reality and the model, all the way to behavioral issues about what increases trust or not, what do people prefer in different contexts, but also lots of algorithmic work to be done to develop easier, multiple, more accurate and better kind of explanations that approximate, you know, black boxes, for example. All in all, we need to develop new tools and methods, of course, while considering human behavior, and then to align those with a lot of interdisciplinary research, which is fascinating and hopefully, you know, fun also. That's all. I'm happy to kind of discuss.
Thank you very much, Theos. It was very good to see that you have given us some guidance for future research. We open the floor to the audience. If you have questions, please raise your hand, and Jasone will give you a right to the microphone and the camera. And if not, please put your question on the chat.
Must be possible to stop sharing, I guess, but I don't know how to share.
I think
you just have to click on the circle with the square. In share application, you're sharing applications, just in the right. There.
Here.
Yeah.
Stop sharing.
Okay. So, are there any questions from the audience? Theos, I was curious about the incidences that you were talking about. Who would be reporting these incidences? Is it a modeler? Is it a citizen? Is it a, yeah?
It's a very good question, Dora. So, well, we don't know yet, obviously, but I'll make a parallel. I mentioned that one of the areas that is under a lot of development these days is the space of so-called online trust and safety, where the incidence is there, incidence in quote, is let's say some harmful content on Twitter or something, right? So, or some illegal content on Twitter, or illegal product being sold on eBay or something. That's an incidence, right? The same equivalent thing. The question is who reports those? So currently, lots of the work is done through AI algorithms that detect those things. So in our case, maybe there is tests that check and monitor, you know, AI monitoring methods that do it automatically. You have users reporting this. You have law enforcement agencies reporting this. You have NGOs, which in that space is called, they are called trusted flaggers, that the regulation will require every country to have. That actually their job is to actually also report this. And then you have, of course, internal to the company people who, you know, have to manage all those reports and ensure the process is such that it's transparent and fair, because otherwise we'll start reporting on each other and kind of, you know, blaming each other, right? So this kind of processes of building these databases is still very, very early.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you for your answer. So, Michelle, you have a question. So, Jasone, could you give?
Do you hear me?
Yes.
Thank you for your presentation. What is the algorithmic advice? In the literature, I see sometimes papers, algorithmic advice.
I've seen, I don't know if I've seen this term or not. But I assume this is, I'm not sure what you refer to, frankly, because there are also different communities having been working on this topic already from the 70s, right, if not earlier. So I would, without me knowing, but I would guess this is the recommendation as an the output of a black of an algorithm in terms of, let's say, predicting something, right, and that can be used as a decision support, basically, for a human to decide. I'm not sure, frankly. So... yeah, I guess I'm not helping you here, but let's say this is in the case of a credit score, is this credit score coming out of the algorithm that the bank employee will use to make a final decision.
Right. And another question about the algorithm fairness. So as we have lots of stakeholders in different problems, in your case, can you elaborate a little bit about algorithmic fairness in your research? Or one of your research that you did?
So I haven't done work on algorithmic fairness. So in that sense, I cannot say anything about my work in algorithmic fairness because I haven't done anything in algorithmic fairness. But of course now a question can be, what's the relation between AI explainability and algorithmic fairness? Well, I guess the broader answer for this is that, in general, AI explainability can help us better understand and improve models.
Mm-hmm.
And understanding and improving models can help improving models, not only in terms of accuracy and generalization, et cetera, but also improving in terms of fairness. So that's kind of the link. But I haven't done myself any work on fairness, so yeah, I don't know.
Very good. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much. So... Felipe, you have a question? Yes, Felipe?
Sorry, I was not using the microphone. Thank you for the presentation. So since we were mentioning about saying what is the best or not, or model, sorry, if I say correctly, not really be sure of what's the best model, for example, for any type of classification. Have you heard about conformal predictions? So this is a very recent paradigm that tries to quantify the uncertainty of certain predictions. So for example, you train several models and using that, so you train several models and use this type of prediction. Oops. Can you hear me correctly?
Sorry, yes, but I missed one thing. You train several models and then you do what?
Oh yeah, so conformal prediction essentially tells you that you're gonna have certain uncertainty measured with certain statistical assurances. So that allows you to essentially say this one is gonna be better than the other one because I minimize the uncertainty.
Yeah, so first of all, thanks for the pointer. I'd love to know more about this. I don't think I've seen this. Having said this, I'm not sure how this could possibly help us answer the question whether we have found the best black box or the best white box or best whatever. I can see how, if I understand correctly, I can see how this gives you some sense of uncertainty, but I'm not sure I get how this can answer the question. But I'll be happy to talk about this offline, of course, because mm-hmm. that sounds potentially useful.
Thank you.
Okay, so I think we will leave it here. Oh, we have another question. Sorry, one more, and then Belen. Yes, Sonia, you can give the rights to Belen.
Yeah. Hello. Can you hear me now?
Yes, we do.
Thank you. Thanks a lot for the talk. Very interesting. In the last part, you kind of like did, I guess, based on kind of like a questionnaire, you did a comparison on the users, how they perceive, you know, counterfactual versus the other one, which is basically the list of the importance and the importance of the different variables in the final model. I wonder if you know, you have any sense or have studied somehow from the user's point of view, how well perceived are decision trees models, because we perceive them as highly interpretable because kind of like most of us, we are mathematicians, kind of like, you know, we like that, it's kind of like very clear, you have the picture. But do you have any sense on how, you know, final users perceive that? And, you know, linked to that is like, do you think they would perceive as interpretable something a bit more complex, like, for example, a combination of few trees or something like that? Or that's kind of like way beyond what they expect to be interpretable?
Yeah, no, thanks for the question. Very good question. And and it's a question, well, there is no black and white. It's not that users prefer this and after a point they don't prefer this or whatever, right? So, however, what we experimented with was with very, very small classification trees. What does small mean? We've been just anchored on, you know, number seven being the number of leaves, especially transforms and links to a rule. Why seven? Because, you know, that's the usual number you see when it comes to memory, shorter memory kind of average number of things people can remember, or et cetera, right? So again, some people are nine, some people are three, whatever, it doesn't matter. So we did experiment with this, assuming they are more understandable, but we did not study preferences between, let's say, a small classification tree and the random forest, because we assumed the random forest, which is an ensemble, as you said, is not understandable by users.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you very much, Belen, and thank you very much, Theos, for, as I said, bringing new lines of research and also making us think again about the importance of trust when it comes to artificial intelligence. So we close today the session, and next week we will have a young online seminar series with three bright junior speakers from different countries. Thank you very much and see you next week. And see you soon, Theos.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.